up, Sauce Gang, and welcome back to the channel. Hot Sauce Beats here with a banger reaction for you, and we are checking out a channel, a creator, for the very first time that you guys have been recommending a lot lately, and I'm talking about Sam Onella? Onelia? I think it's Onella Academy, and their brand new video, Banned and Controversial Foods. No clue what this is about other than the fact, well, the title, Banned and Controversial Foods, but I know they also do animations, which you know we love animations on this channel. So I'm super stoked to check this out. But before we do, can you show Sam Onella Academy some love by subscribing to the channel? And fam, we're trying to get to 250,000 subs. So if you haven't yet, please smash that subscribe button and join the Sauce Gang family. But enough talking, let's get to reacting and roll that bomb ass intro.
Hot Sauce Beats is finally here. Hot Sauce Beats is finally here. Eat, sleep, make beats. Eat, sleep, make beats.
Hot Sauce Beats. Woo-hoo!
Oh, I'm excited to check out something new, chat. Let it roll.
Ooh, indubitably. Sounds very fancy.
Controversial
hey
foods.
Majors, so I'd like to start off with a little biology lesson. When a species finds itself living on an island, it can start to evolve in strange ways based on the different pressures applied by the new environment.
This I don't know if I want to eat that cow!
And while it can manifest in a lot of ways, the biggest driving force is often a lack of predators. For example, the dodo lost its ability to fly since there was nothing to flee from, the St. Kilda field mouse got twice as big since it no longer had to hide, and with no one around to bully them, the Sardinians started putting maggots in their cheese. Meet Kazumatsu, literal translation, rotten cheese. It's made by taking a perfectly wheel of pecorino and letting a special type of fly lay eggs in it. The fly babies then work to partially digest the cheese, rendering it goopy and wet and maybe quite tasty and worm-filled. Now, cheese is-
Whoa! Oh, dude. So I'm a big cheese guy, right? I wish I liked blue cheese. I know a lot of you guys are like, you're crazy. How do you not like blue cheese? I just can't get past the taste, man, and the aftertaste. It's terrible. Again, I'm a cheese guy, so I wish I could, and it's like this, like, why? I understand mold does stuff to cheese, and it makes it moldy cheese, but maggots?
This is a concept is already quite suspect. It's clotted milk that you fill with bacteria and mold and let sit for a while. But cheese is safe and delicious. Cheese is my friend. I trust cheese. So my guard would be down around Kazumatsu. I've learned to look past a cheese's childhood. Strange upbringings are what give them their character. But it turns out, those maggots are still alive. And if you don't chew well enough, they can cause enteric meiosis, which is a fancy term for fly larvae living in your intestines. Symptoms are similar to
food. No, thank you. Imagine you go do a number two and you see some little maggots swimming in the water. Not today, Satan. Not today.
Except with the added psychic pain of knowing that, again, your bowels are full of squiggly new friends. It's for this reason that Kazumatsu is banned in the EU and elsewhere. A black market exists, which is wild, and it's not a small one. In 2019, the illicit Kazumatsu trade was estimated to be worth 2 to 3 million euros annually. Personally, I would just do it prohibition.
So you could be a millionaire,
Chet. Definitely don't put these fried eggs on this sumptuous wheel of pecorino. But if you do, you absolutely shouldn't keep it warm and damp for a week. But although it's traditional to leave the larvae alive when you eat your mag and cheese, some consumers still prefer them dead, shockingly. In that case, one puts the cheese in a sealed bag, and when the maggots run out of oxygen, they writhe around and fling themselves all over the place. This is heard as a distinct pitter-patter against the walls of the bag, and when the sound stops, the contents are ready to eat. Like popcorn. Shark fin soup is one most of us have heard about already, mostly in reference to its effect on shark populations and the wastefulness that goes into making it. Until recently, I never looked into the nature of the dish itself. I figured, right, the fins are just the only part of the shark worth eating. Big whoop, it's probably not much different from, like, swordfish. Apparently, though, I had it backwards. Shark fins aren't even meat. They're made almost entirely of cartilage and collagen. They are the last part we should be eating. That's why it's only made into soup, because without being soaked in broth, it has zero flavor or nutritional.
Why not just eat any other soup ever? Any other soup ever!
No value on its own. Their only redeeming
almost
quality
tasteless.
Is their unique mouthfeel due to how stringily the collagen grows in structures called ceratotrichia. The texture has been described as somewhere between chewy and crunchy, which I find describes most things, actually. Other adjectives present on Wikipedia
foods.
Include snappy, gelatinous, and sinewy. The exact sensation of eating this substance remains a mystery to me, and the unintended side effect of all this research is that I now really want to try it. Like, it's a big trade. I've got to be the one that's wrong.
Dude, that's a lot of shark fins, bro.
trade. I've got to be the one that's wrong. There is imitation shark fin soup available, but I've already decided that it's not nearly as good. So I've come up with a compromise to this controversy. Everyone on Earth gets just one bite. Say there's 10 bites to a fin, 4 fins to a shark. 200 million sharks die, sure, a necessary casualty. But then we can end the practice forever. All done. You can finally rest, Mr. Ming. Come here, baby.
Yeah, Ming!
What? Aki. Where? Aki. The aki is a fruit originally from West Africa, which is most commonly associated with Jamaican cuisine, where it appears in such dishes as aki and saltfish. These alien kidneys here are called the arils, and they're the only part of the fruit that's actually eaten. The flavor is on the savory side, being described as kind of nutty or bean-like. What makes the aki controversial, though, is the effects it can cause when prepared improperly. If the arils are allowed to completely ripen, they're harmless. But if you eat them too early, or don't thoroughly clean off all the non-aril stuff, they can cause Jamaican vomiting sickness. This disease doesn't sound real. It sounds like it belongs next to Eastern sweats and Tangerian bone grindings, but that's actually an official term, and as for symptoms, does what it says on the tin. Plus maybe death. While aki-based products aren't outright illegal in the United States, they are very tightly regulated, and the raw fruit itself cannot be imported. So if you're American and want to try it, your options are fully cooked canned aki or going to Florida, where a few people grow it domestically. Next we have bird's nest soup. This is another one that I've vaguely heard of, and for years I just assumed the name was a playful metaphor, like ants on a log or shit on a shingle. Turns out, nope, this dish contains an actual bird nest. Not like a pile of twigs like I was picturing, but rather a specific type of nest only made by certain species of swiftlets. These nests are mostly made out of mucins, which are a set of proteins that, among other things, serve to thicken all those wonderful secretions our bodies make. There's a little bit in human saliva.
Why? How do you come up with this stuff? Like, is someone just severely bored? And they're like, yeah, let's boil that bird's nest and see how it tastes. Yummy. Delicious.
Saliva, a little bit more in mucus, and in swiftlet saliva, look out, pal. So all the swiftlet does is it finds a nice wall, starts laying out fat strings of slobber, which dry, and eventually she's got a nice place to roost. That is, right up until some gourmand says,
today I crave bird spit. You can keep the eggs, though.
And they then reconstitute it back into its original gelatinous texture. Unfortunately, these nests can't enter the US, since, believe it or not, eating bird saliva is a great way to catch bird flu. And now the time has come speak of the ortolan. The ortolan is a kind of bunting, which is a sort of passerine, which is a type of bird. They're birds. Like many animals, they have a long history of being eaten by the French. But what separates the ortolan from your average squab or pheasant is the unique way in which it is prepared and eaten. They're typically caught with nets and kept in the dark, which causes them to overeat for some reason. Once it's about twice as fat, the entire bird is then thrown into a container of brandy, alive, and sealed in. While this serves to marinate the creature, it also drowns in the process, thereby killing one bird with no stones. The ortolan is then roasted, plucked, and presented whole to the consumer, who inserts the carcass into their mouth, feet first. As they chew, one hand continues holding the bird's head, while the other picks out the larger bones. This whole ritual is usually performed with a towel or large napkin over one's head. There's a few explanations for the purpose of the towel. Some say it's just there to keep the aromas in, while others say it's there to, quote, shield from God's eyes the shame of such a decadent and disgraceful act. Yeah, this one I'm okay with not trying, actually. Notable fans of this dish include, not joking, Bill Cosby and the guy who invented the lobotomy. Ah, to be part of that social club. Our mission is to eat birds whole and then make people not remember things. Killing ortolans was banned across the EU in 2007.
Just letting it, a live animal just drown in some brandy. I'm gonna seal it just for good measure. Trapping those aromas.
Not for any ethical reason, but because French people did this so much that the entire ortolan population was threatened. Thankfully, as of 2018, their conservation status is under least concern, so hopefully the French can get back to it soon. Anyway, that's all I have for today. Till next time, I'm Sam Anella, and thank you for watching.
Anella, it is Anella. Okay, Samonella! Sam Anella. Sam Anella. What was I saying? Sam O'Neill? Oh my goodness. Oh, dude, I hate when I do something so dumb and I catch it like before I post a video. And I'm like, the comments are just gonna be lit up. Anyways, Salmonella Academy, amazing channel. Dude, this is like the most useless but useful and hilarious information that you're gonna get. I'm wondering if his whole channel is like this. Let's see what. So chat, let me know in the comments, what are some other salmonella videos? Presidential pets, Zhang Zongchang, animal names, unlucky ship. Let me know, Timothy Dexter, Inuit folklore. Yeah, let me know what other ones you want me to check out. This was amazing, and I feel bad for birds. So, oh, and then the bird vomit soup. Anyways, let me know what you guys think. Which one was the most suspicious? And make sure you show Salmonella some love by subscribing to their channel. And again, fam, excuse me, we're trying to get to 250,000 subs. So if you haven't yet, please smash that subscribe button and join the Souls Gang family. Enjoy the rest of your evening. And remember, it's Eat Sleeping Big Beats. And as usual, we count on another. That's all I got. Boom, I'm out. Gonna be love for the Sauce Gang. Peace out, chat. Boom.